Let's get right, man. Let's. KB, you know what this is, right? Hello, KB.
Skip.
Come on, KB.
This has more than you're expecting.
You know nothing about this, KB. Come on, bro. David, you know what album this was? You know what album this is? 1999, baby.
It's 1998.
Oh, Jeff. Rewind.
You can't baffle people now. We got fact checkers.
1989. I'm sorry. Wait, I apologize.
What song is it?
This is the great Taylor Swift.
And what's the song?
Come on, don't do this to me.
Yeah.
Like, nah, this is really
gonna be the most fun I ever had.
Style, bro. It's called style.
Check Spotify on style.
Okay, name me two more songs on the album if you know it so well. If you guys know it so well. Two more songs on the album.
You never said we know it.
Yeah. Give me a second.
You see that response? Someone actually questions you and you're like, come on, man. Tell me more things.
I get defensive.
I'm right. Yeah, I get a
little defensive.
Is New York in there? Is that one of them?
Nope. Oh, Welcome to New York. Yep. Yes. That's the first song on the album.
That counts. Anyone else? No. I think I know another one.
A Swifty.
Another Swifty.
A Swifty. You're not a Swifty too, huh?
Nah. And Bad Blood. Isn't Bad Blood in this?
Bad Blood is here. Yep. Oh, wow.
Damn. Try another thing they don't know.
Thanks.
Wow. Thanks. My favorite is Blank Space. We all know Blank Space.
Go on. Put it on.
KB, I'll introduce you. You know when you were in your room having relationship problems? curled up in the blanket.
This is a hypothetical.
Yeah.
Let me pretend. Oh my God, look at that face.
You look like my next mistake.
What's the foot? It starts with the foot. Starts with the feet. The feet. That's so well coordinated.
Donovan wants to sing to this so bad. No, don't be shy, man. About me, so hey, let's be friends. I'm dying to see how this one ends. Grab your passport and my hand. Can make the bad guys good for a weekend. Yeah, you heard that? She can make the bad guys good for a weekend. That's what she said.
Man, I've never seen this side of a Tam. This is cool.
We're multifaceted.
Deeper than just that surface level you're used to.
It's a little deeper than that. Anyway, shout out to the Searchers Podcast. We're here with the Caps ladies. We have a few of the Caps ladies.
High fives.
We have a few of the Caps ladies.
Love the Caps.
Throw it out, KB.
Yeah, and a Tim. Here, throw it out.
Let's go.
Good. Would you rather every time you sneeze, you vomit, or every time you fart, you poo yourself?
Sneeze and vomit. Easy to clean that up. That's
sneeze and vomit. I don't want to be vomiting all the time, you know.
Yeah, man, but at least
I just run to the ladies' room every time I need
to sneeze half the time.
Yeah, but you vomit. Like it could be a little throw up in your throat. Like
It
could be a little poo.
You gotta take care of that. Wait, you're gonna wear a nappy all the time? Come on, man.
Like
I'm not. That's just not my thing. I'd rather like throw up and then sorry, it's a condition I have. Exactly. I much prefer that. That's a good question, though.
What do you choose, Tim?
I'm not going to be a contrarian this time. I think I'll vomit instead.
Okay.
I think I'll vomit.
You also have stinky vomit breath all the time, then.
Oh God.
Chewing gum.
Yeah.
How hard is it?
Chewing right now.
You're going to change your pants.
The other one. It's too much.
Farting.
I want to share this mic because I only got one mic.
Have any of you? This is great. Have any of you ever, you know, been with an intimate person you're intimate with and farted while you were together?
Oh, we've asked that question.
Have we asked that question before?
Yeah, but not to.
Yeah, this is great. Have you ever farted?
During the act or like just in general?
Whoa, whoa, we're going way ahead. No. Just at first. When do you let a guy know that you fart? Like you know what I mean?
Straight off the bat.
Hold on. But you're saying a guy, like when have you? Start off with yourself.
Yeah.
You're just like, yeah, whatever, I got this.
No, I'm still a little shy, bro. It takes me a little while. Well, most.
It's either you or me, so someone's got to own up.
Someone's got to do it, right?
You're just walking out, aren't you? You're just like getting up and going, that's terrible. Even though it's you. Like, and you're out of there.
How dare you?
Anything. You're like, nah, that's not me.
How dare you? But like, when is too early to let them know that like, you fart? Because you know, girls, you try to hide stuff for a long time.
It's normal though, everyone farts.
Like, yeah,
it's
but
not a secret.
Actually, girls don't fart.
Exactly, see, girls don't fart.
Or go to the bathroom.
Yeah.
Or go to the bathroom. How about during the act, as Abby asked? during the act.
Abby obviously has. Yo,
how polite, during the act again.
Abby run away from that, honestly. How did get act. Out of there?
During the act.
You're stuck.
Steph.
So first day's too early.
First day.
I gotta put that
in. I mean, are you...
Well, I mean, if you're really drunk, no one notices.
No one notices. What if that...
You're not a microphone person.
I'm not gonna go back.
So first day's too much. What? Married 20 years? Yeah, it's probably good.
You're fighting all the time. Right? You're fighting all throughout the house.
Give each other high fives. You are amazing.
Okay, but are you that comfortable to where you can see your partner in the toilet? You know, like some people will, couples will, I find this weird, but like, see their partner
keep
taking a shit or like, you know, like it's yeah, nothing.
It's one weird. Brushing. I think there's some things that can stay private, and I think that's one of them. Yeah.
What's the line?
That's the line.
That is the line?
Yeah, the toilet door can be closed.
That's the line.
Is it stinky as well?
It's a vulnerable position, isn't it?
Put it out there. No one here has children. Once you have children, you realize there's no fucking line.
Yeah.
Why? Because it's like, as soon as you go to the toilet, it's like, what are you doing? You're like, leave me alone. They're like, so-and-so punched so-and-so.
Yeah.
Open the door up. They like, come in. And they're standing there and you're like, just telling you, there's no line. So you don't
Why are you
have
scaring
kids?
Everyone
don't
from
have
having kids?
That is the line.
All I'm saying
is that like you have lines, kids is not the time, not the thing to do.
It's impossible.
It's shit.
Dating is impossible these days.
Come on. What do you have to say? Tell us how you really feel.
I just think dating is impossible these days. Like dating apps are just, you're on there for an hour and then you get off and you delete it.
So it's only dating apps.
Well, and then, like, I just feel like going out, you just don't find people the way that people used to because of social media. Like, everyone's just sitting out at the bar on their phone. Yeah, no one's actually interacting. Like, no one goes to the bar and isn't on their phone.
At the bar?
Well, at the bar, out eating, whatever.
Is it as well? Because everything is so immediately gratification. Like, you can get it straight away. No one's willing to have, like, a conversation, go, hey, look, you seem pretty cool. Let's catch up tomorrow for a coffee. And then, oh, what, you didn't want to hook up with me? No, I just want a coffee. Like, you know, you seem cool. And then that could go for a week or 2 weeks or a month. You know what I mean? Without actually just getting to know somebody. Like, that would be like, non-existent, right? No, it would be. Like, I was saying to a Tam, like back in the day, you would, because there's no phones, you had to see, you saw someone at like a corner store, right? And you'd talk to them. And you'd talk to them for 6 months, you know what I mean? And then eventually you'd ask them out if you liked them, you know, if they liked you. But because there's no phones, you couldn't search them up on social media. That's the only time you saw them. Or if you went to, you know, basketball, you'd only see them at basketball. And then you'd get to know them over the months and months and months. And so you actually got to know people. And then you know, decide if you want to do something further. But now it's like instant, right? You just...
I also think on dating apps, like you're already finding out things about people before you meet them. So like when you actually meet for the first time, it's like, I already know these things. So like you don't actually get to know them.
And you can stalk them, right?
Yeah, exactly. Like you're doing your homework before you get there.
Okay, what makes you meet that person if there's so much options?
You don't.
Or what makes you even interact with that person? You have to connect on other socials first, or is it I like you, let's coffee or whatever? Because you're saying you don't, right? You're saying even if you like them, you don't meet.
How do you know you like someone on social media?
That's what I'm saying.
Like, you're on social media and you're looking at a photo, and obviously it's the most photoshopped picture they could get. You know what I mean? And then their profile's the most photoshopped, you know, profile they could get. So you're getting them at their best, and you're like, ooh, that sounds good. Then you meet them in real life, and you're like, damn. Like what? Why would you even? I don't know what you'd do. And then we haven't got to love, because love's a whole other thing. Like,
they don't exist today.
No. But if it's all fake to start with, how would you even get to that point? Because everything is like so contrived and fake. And
they're not looking for love, KB.
What's that?
They're not looking for love.
Damn. Are you just speaking from the heart? I'm not looking for love, KB. Is that what you meant to say? I heard you say they, but I heard me.
You can find love on a dating app?
I think it's rare. I think in some cases, absolutely. Mm. But like, I don't think it's impossible. It's not how I want to find love.
So how are you going to find someone?
Exactly. It's a great question.
They're not going to show up on your doorstep.
They're not.
I feel like dating apps just a game of hot or not. Like, you just swipe. Yes, no, yes. Like, it's just a cycle, hey.
Would you approach anyone? So if guys aren't approaching in real life, would you guys take the initiative? Do guys approach? Do guys, well, they say they don't, but do guys approach? When was the last time someone actually went and came and said hi in real life? With interest.
Don't go out much.
I was bowling one time with friends and had a guy come up to me, but he was drunk. So, like, and that's a red flag. Like, that's an ick. Yeah. That is an ick.
Like super drunk. Like, just a little tip that you just give
and
you.
And more often or not, going for one thing only, which is, like,
yeah.
And that's
so
the point.
No one's actually going to anyone with no intent. It's just like, hey, like, you seem cool. What's going on? What are you guys about? And then they walk away and that was it. And you're like, oh, that person's even... No one's doing that, right? Because everyone wants instant gratification. I want it now. And you know, they know. And it's literally like, are you hot enough or not for me to make that decision?
I don't believe that. I don't believe that. There's people out there just going to say hi to people. That is happening.
No, but I'm saying... I'm not saying it's not happening. I'm saying it's rare.
It's very small.
It's not as common now. Whereas when you had no other choice... Because that's the only way you met people and you want a vibe. So we talk about energy all the time. I go and talk to somebody. I know immediately whether or not we're even closely, remotely vibing.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Like on the internet, you don't get that because it's, you know, you just go, oh, I like your picture or whatever it is or your thing. But you meet them, you know straight away. Whereas if all you do is meet people, then you would know your vibes and their vibes much more clearly. Whereas when you're never vibing or very rarely vibing, right, it's all social media, so you don't get the practice. So then you're sort of, you got to learn how to do that when you occasionally meet people in real life.
Okay, so if you guys see a guy you like, you think they're handsome, they have long socks, they're not wearing...
They got no spittle in their mouth.
I guess. Whatever.
They have hair.
Yeah, whatever. Have hair.
Like crazy stuff like that.
Yeah,
then,
all that nonsense. Are you going to find them online?
Oh, do you go say hello to them?
Nah, they're not doing that. They ain't doing that. They're not doing that.
Too shy. You're not finding them online though. If you see them in person, right? Like,
I was just saying, you see them in person
and then go and approach them.
Nah, they're not doing that. So they're going to go find them online, right?
Don't do anything. It's just a, oh.
I wish.
I think. I got another question. So let's say you meet someone in real life, because this used to be a thing.
The wrong people.
No. But this used to be a thing where they weren't necessarily interested in you to start with, but you liked them. So you pursued them and you sort of talked them over a long period of time.
Stalk them. Is that what you're saying?
Is that what you do now?
No, whoa, chill out.
Damn,
what do you mean pursue? What's up?
That was a big jump. So for me, I'm talking about talking, and you're like, so you stalked them.
I'm just trying to get some clarity here.
I wasn't aware you just jumped straight there.
I just want some clarity here.
What's after that?
No.
You put a little tracker under there.
Chill out.
You know, Kieran, a little tracker on the car. Track, you know where they live. Like, you watch them for a while.
What do you mean by pursue them?
So you talk to them and they're not interested, or they're unavailable, or they're thinking about somebody else or whatever, right? But you're just nice to them, you're just friends with them, and then over time, like that may turn into something.
So you disguise as a friend.
Again, where are you going? Is it so this is so stalking, so is it, and then you pretend you're a friend. Am I the only one?
Yo, talk to me. Yo, talk to me.
Am I the only one who thinks that you like? I just want to get clarity here.
That's all I'm trying to do. I'm trying to get some clarity.
I like this way your brain went straight away. So then you pretend you're a friend. Disguise that you're being friendly. No, I'm actually talking about being friendly.
Oh, okay.
Like without intent. Look, like you're cool, but if we're not cool, that's all right too. But I'm going to be friendly regardless.
Okay.
I'm not pretending or disguise. Let's go to a movie. Damn. Times have changed.
That is terrible.
I'm not. I'm glad I missed that whole thing. That's a lot.
I'm just getting clarity.
Yeah, we probably need to just.
So what is this?
We need to unpack that.
Just
to.
Give me all this shit. Shut the whole thing. So. What are you guys' answer to that question? I was just trying to get clarity.
So the question was like if you're around, say for example, like you think someone's good looking or you think they're nice or whatever, right? But you don't know them very well and you're shy, so you're not going to go up to them and say, okay, like let's go out, like really forward. But you want to get to know them more, so you're just in that social group, you talk to them, you're willing to wait longer periods of time because you don't know them very well. You know, and then over time you get to know them, and then you can make a decision later once you get to know them better. Now, that used to be the way because you didn't have social media to stalk them and see who they liked and who their friends were and make these artificial judgments by all of their social media stuff, which really doesn't give you an insight into who they are because you've got to make all these assumptions. But and so it used to be the fact that you had to get to know people before you felt like even asking people out. You know what I mean? Like, in that way. So... like, you guys don't do that anymore? You don't, like, wait, like, get to know people?
I think it was just straight to social media, honestly.
What did I say, KB? Sorry,
I think it is. I think that's just, like...
What if they don't have social media?
That's a red flag.
That's a red flag. You don't have social media? I had to get to know you?
Yeah.
I'm out.
Yeah.
Wow, that's actually hilarious. Go, Brett. This is why Japan has an aging population and there's no one's having kids anymore.
They just chill in their room. They chill in their room
yeah. and no one wants relationships or kids. Yeah. So Kenta just came back, our assistant coach, who's Japanese, and he's like, they have a huge, huge issue because there's no relationships. Because everyone just like, it's either, you know, social media, meet somebody, do whatever you need to do, then go on. But no one wants to, because everyone's about money and doing well in business. And the country's like, well, we're running out of people because the population's so old. Because everyone's literally doing what you're talking about, but no one actually has this goal or ideal of having a family and kids, and because that's below their expectations. Like, well, it's insane. Like, they're actually just going to breathe themselves out.
Is that on women or men?
Both. Because both are about for
I think both. Themselves,
both ways. I just think it's really interesting.
I blame women. Sorry, I just on.
Oh,
you blame women?
It's an ick. Add that to the list.
Whoa, that's an ick.
That's
why? Why do you blame women?
I think you feel attacked. There's a pressure to be
independent,
super independent, and
self-sustaining, happy with their own lives,
not
dependent on men.
Not depending
That's
on
that. Actually fucking horrible. What crazy world do we live in?
But I think you can be super independent and self-sustaining and still have a partner.
Absolutely. 100%.
Why can't you do that?
I completely agree.
Yeah.
I'm saying a lot of women are being pressured to neglect that maternal side of.
I agree with the fact that men can't have babies.
Yeah, yeah.
So really, like, men can't go, all right, look, I would love to be a father, but I can't have babies. So yeah. I need to find a woman to be able to have children. And so men are actually really, really powerless around having children.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, mm-hmm. Actually,
and so if women don't want to have kids, the pop humanity is going to disappear. So again, women actually have all the power in humanity and all the power in the world if they chose to hold that MasterCard, which they don't, which is why men try to convince them that they're powerless and they need to have kids and be subservient. But that's a whole nother conversation. But women actually have all the power, and men know that. And so men's job is to convince them they don't. And women are working out they got the power, but now it's gone the other way because they're like, we can do whatever we want. Yes, you can, but you're the only ones who can have children. So what are you going to do about it?
Is there a pressure there? This is the question. Is there a pressure to be like, chase your career rather than chase that love thing, that family?
I think so. Like in professional sport, I think in basketball, like, people, not so much these days. I think, like, there are a select few who are going the other way, like having babies then coming back to play. But yeah. I think, like, it's traditionally, like, you need to play out until you're 33. And then if you can't play anymore at that age, then you should have a family.
And have family.
Yeah, I don't think it's like, oh, if you're in love and you want to have a kid when you're 24 and then come back and start playing again when you're 26. Mm. Like, that's not normal, I don't think. And I think when you hear of girls doing that, you're like, oh, what the hell? Like, you can do that and then come back and play. Like, Michaela Cann, who plays for Logan, has 3 kids.
Right.
And she's
still killing.
She's killing it.
Still,
like,
killing.
But it's hard to get for her to get in the WNBL because she comes with 3 kids.
Yeah.
Mm. So it's like, okay, we signed a contract with her, and then it's like, you got 3 kids. So now how do we, as a club, support that?
So that's what I'm saying. Coming up, even if you're 20, 22, whatever, and you have, and you're in a serious relationship, that would suck to have that pressure of like, damn, can't have a kid right now. Shouldn't have a kid right now because I have these goals and I'll be looked at a certain way. That's what I mean by,
yeah, but that would
that
suck.
Pressure sucks.
Yeah, that would suck.
Is
but
that,
but unfortunately, I don't think you can undo that because your partner can't have kids. Like, you know, the guy can't have kids. Let's say you're the breadwinner because you're the one who's killing it and you got all those things and you're at that level. If it's a male partner, you can't have children.
Yeah.
So the pressure's there regardless of how much you want to, you know, you've got to actually put that to the side just because, you know, I guess strictly biologically speaking, women, you know, have children. So you can't do anything about that, which is, I guess, frustrating. If you wanted kids.
Yeah, it's way different to back then. You guys were having kids at 18 and all that shit. Like,
you guys?
I mean, sorry.
I'm like, because I just want to clarify, I can't have children. I like what you said right at me. You guys had children. I'm like, bro, we just went through that.
I don't know what you are.
I'm not capable.
I don't know what you are. You know, it's just very different now. So I'm sure there's a stat that says people are having children way later.
Yeah,
I'm sure there's a stat of people having children way later. That's why I asked that question, you know.
So when does that kick in? When are you meant to have children? When's it okay to have children?
When are you meant to have children?
Now? 30?
I don't know.
33? So 40 is kind of that cutoff, right?
I think it's different for everyone.
So there's no, like, definite thing anymore?
Oh, there's still, like, a cutoff, like, biologically. Like, you know, 40, you have your cutoff.
Yeah.
40.
Starts just increasing, like, Down syndrome and all that stuff. Yeah. But you can now freeze your eggs so that they're young eggs and then you can have kids later, but without that risk, right?
But do you really want to be having kids that late, you know, and then they get 20 and you're 65?
Imagine your knees.
Yeah, no, it's not happening.
How could you pick them up?
Yeah.
Chase them around.
Did you guys have people talking to you about birth control and stuff like that? Family? Or was that through
positive
school?
Do you have anything positive? Like, talking about kids and, like, because you guys are all, like, elite athletes. So was there ever any positive conversation around this of empowerment and choice? And What, just factual even?
I mean, I never had anything negative said to me. I think we had, like, a fair bit of education around it, and it was never negative. It was kind of just, like, I remember having, like, a little, like, conversation when I was with a team and, like, we're talking about it, and it was kind of just, like, how to bounce back from if you did have a kid. It was never, you shouldn't have one during your career.
Nope.
I think in college, I know for me, in college, there was one year where our coach sat us down and we had, like, a big thing for, like, an hour and a half, went over birth control and everything. Just, like, just as, like, a precaution. She was also always, like, you know, if it happens, we're here for you, but, you know, you're here to play basketball. So I think at some point there is, like, a bit of, I guess, pressure on, like, look, you're here to perform. We don't particularly want you getting pregnant, but we're here to support you if you do. But I think it's definitely around still.
Yeah. That's cool. So where are we going with this? It's a cool conversation.
Wherever.
Because now the attention is totally off you, talking about the
language. Oh, that's great.
I see what we've done
children. Let's talk about children and getting pregnant, because that sounds like a great topic. Yeah, that's nothing to do with me.
We just sit back and...
Nice.
I mean, you know, I think they're important conversations. It's all fun and games right now.
Until there's a baby.
I thought the point was it wasn't fun and games, because basically no one can find people except for online, which is trash.
No one's looking for it, KB. I'm telling you this.
No one's looking for it.
No one is looking for it.
No one's looking for a lot, like a like someone to connect with and spend time with. Is that what you're saying? Very few people?
Very few people.
Very few young people.
Very few young people. I think you gotta hit a certain age. You have to hit a certain age. I mean, for a long time, I was not looking for...
27, 28?
Yeah, I'm 27.
27?
For a long time.
Is that the age?
For a long time.
27.
Maybe.
Why is David laughing?
Maybe.
27, 34.
like David right now, he's not thinking about none of that shit. He couldn't care less about no connection, nothing.
Because he's 18. He's like, man, I'm at uni.
He just wants to be at uni enjoying himself. You know.
So what is it? 27, 28, 35? What's the age?
And I don't think there's anything wrong with that.
Nothing. I just want to know the age.
Men's side, women's side, at all. Like, you're supposed to find out what you like and what you don't like. What you can tolerate, what you can't tolerate. Jumping into it early is cool. But, like, if it doesn't work, there's nothing wrong with that. If you meet someone who just wants that you said, you choose to participate or not. But I don't think, even on the women's side, you can't bash girls for wanting to. There's a lot who also just want to enjoy themselves in this.
But you're saying that, like, a lot of people don't at the moment.
And there's nothing wrong with that.
Yeah, I'm not saying there's anything wrong with that. I'm saying that a lot of people don't want to engage in connectedness and relationships.
That's my opinion.
Is that true?
I think there's plenty of people that want to. I think it's just a matter of, like, I don't know, finding the right one. I think everyone kind of wants, at the end of the day, like, everyone wants to find someone to be with. You don't want to be alone, right? So, like, I think that's what I think. So, I don't know, I think.
What do you guys think as well?
I mean, I also feel like if we're talking about love, are we talking about going out to find love, or does love find you? Like, because you talk about, you know, we work full time, we play basketball. Like, where are we finding these people we're falling in love with? Yeah.
Where are we finding the time to do any of
the time to do this? Like,
so for me, the approach would be if that was an intention, you know, like you actually wanted to do that. So you got to have that intention to start with, which you don't, which is actually, I recommend, don't do it and just enjoy yourself the rest of your life. That would be my recommendation. But if you chose to go down that path of heartbreak and heartache and being emotionally destroyed, you know, if it doesn't work out and you want to take that risk and that's on you, then how do you do that? And I think it's a lot more difficult going on social media. But if you did, then getting a wider variety of people to you know, get to know personalities you like and what you can cope with and what you, you know, like, because obviously no one's perfect, so you've got to learn how to be, like, you know, be perfect together, all those kind of cliches. But you got to meet a bunch of people to do it. So So know what you like. You don't have to be in a relationship. Just know that, ooh, that's an ick, that's an ick, that's an ick, that's an ick, that's an ick. You're all out. But I know all these people who are fine, but they're just not it. Whereas on social media, it's just a, you know, as you said, who's the hottest? You know, I mean, you're not really getting to know people or yourself. Because I think it's, I know, just thinking about it now, it's actually getting to know yourself and who you are and what you like and what you're going to tolerate. But how do you get to know yourself if you don't put yourself in a position to get to know yourself? And it's really protected to just, you know, click on like or not like, whatever that is. Because you actually don't have to give yourself to anyone emotionally. It is just that, you know, facade of, okay, this is who I am. He's this, but you don't get to see this. So the only way you get to know yourself is by showing that deeper side. And, you know, unfortunately, having to get burnt lots of times before you actually go, okay, yeah, this is who I am, I think. So I think it's, again, it's cool that you don't have time. It's cool that you're playing basketball. And I recommend you do that for the next 20, 30 years. And then, you know, after that, you might decide to venture into this world. But I just think it's more difficult.
No, but she wants someone to.
What?
As much as you have work and all this, you want someone to snuggle up with.
Oh, yeah, absolutely. At the end of the day, absolutely. You
know, yeah, you still want
to. Absolutely.
Don't you just get a pet dog? Like just
that's
like
the third wheel. Yeah,
no, I'm on Instagram. I don't see an issue.
No, I agree, but it's, you know, like, where do you find the time to find that? Like, you know, like, you're at work all day. I personally don't want to be with anyone that I'm at work. You know, like, I want someone outside of that. But how do you find the time for that? To put yourself out there to go find someone.
I obviously talk a lot. I need to connect this up. I'm trying to give it away. Shut up at 10. I think that you've got to have that intention first. So if you're not looking for something, which is, again, absolutely fine, then you're never looking to find something. So you've got to have that intention, and not with like a desperation, like, oh, you're going to complete me, and if you do this, then I feel like a whole person. It's just more, you know, if I find someone, I find someone, but I am looking. You know what I mean? And you slowly build up.
I feel like you find it when you're not looking, right? So, like, if I'm just, like, cruising around doing life like I always do, da-da-da, I feel like it will find me because I'm, like, just, like, doing me, right? And then people see that and they're like, oh, cool.
Yeah. Again, not going to come knocking on your door.
But you're cruising around.
Yeah.
You're not just in your room, like...
Oh, yeah, you've still got to be out and about and stuff like that and doing you. But you don't need to be actively, like, looking out.
No, not like that. Like, I just mean out and about. Like you got to have an intention, like, that you are interested in having a relationship. So you're open to the idea if this person came into your world, you'd be like, oh, there you go.
But aren't you out and about looking by wearing nice things and...
A better way to phrase it is being open to the possibility or opportunity if it presented itself. You're not going, I need, like, you know, I'm looking for this person.
It's just a mental thing.
You're ready for a relationship if it came along, but you're not desperate for one.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? You're not like, I need that one. It's like, if it comes along, it comes along. But if some people are just completely closed to that, and therefore they're never open to any sort of interaction like that. And I think that's a big differentiation, like, you know, go do you, and if it comes along and you see it, that's cool, and if it doesn't, that's cool too, you're fine either way. But that's the only way you can do it, and I think it just takes time, like, and if it doesn't, then just, you're happy anyway because you're happy being you. Just happy doing you all the time.
Be you.
Be you, love you.
What's your experience? You're not saying much.
Me? Well, I'm in a long-term relationship.
And how did that happened? Did it just hit you?
It just hit me. Like, I was with my friends on school holidays at, like, a gathering thing, so I wasn't looking for anything. I wasn't living at home at the time, so I flew back home. I was, like, hanging out with my friends, knowing that I was gonna go back to where I was living at the time, so I obviously wasn't looking for anything.
Was this in Darwin?
Darwin.
Isn't there, like, 50 people over there? How many people live in Darwin?
Yeah, give or take. So I was out with my friends. We went to, like, a house gathering sort of thing.
Yeah.
Obviously, I'm not looking for anything. Yeah. And I'm going back to the AIS, like, in 2 weeks. I don't, like, why I wouldn't be doing that.
How old
and were you? I was 16.
Did you know them at the time? You didn't know them?
Yeah, briefly, like, went to school together, like, knew of each other and stuff, it's not like, I wouldn't say we were necessarily friends at that stage in both of our lives.
Did you have a crush before?
Nope. Really? I didn't even have any, like, I didn't even know I was going to see him there. Like, I was just there. My friends were like, oh, it's almost Christmas. Like, we're going to this thing. You want to come? I was like, yeah, of course, I'll come. So, I didn't even know I was going to see him there. And then, like, we caught up while I was there. And then, like, I guess I was open to it, I guess. I wasn't like, this is not going to happen, blah, blah, blah.
Right.
And then, yeah, it just snowballed from there.
In the snowballing process.
Has a question.
Who pushed the snowball? What's the moment you know when you meet someone whether they're going to be a friend or something more? When do you know when you meet someone? I'm reiterating because they won't hear it. When do you know? What'd you say? Whether they're going
to. I don't think straight away it's like, oh my God, he's going to be the love of my life. It wasn't like that. I think for me, I just felt like super comfortable, like. The vibe, the energy, like you said before, like matching my energy sort of stuff. And then I think it's like a slow process. I honestly, like, it wasn't a love at first sight sort of thing.
So they disguised as your friend first?
Yes.
Maybe.
And then come on, Karen.
I'm just saying, KB. Hey, David.
All semantics. It's all semantics. Yeah, so there's not necessarily a lightning bolt, but you just kind of, you know, it was easygoing, it was kind of just simple, and you're like, well, this is awfully easy, and then you kept in contact, and you went back to the AIS, and obviously you kept in contact, and it kind of just grew and grew and grew, and there was never a point where the icks outweighed the vibing, I guess.
Yeah, absolutely, that's what happened.
And that's what you do for the next 60 years.
Still vibing. Still vibing.
Yeah, but like that's what it is though, right? Like that's all it is.
Yeah.
What else is it? If you're forcing it, then it's not what it's meant to be. Absolutely. That's cool. And it's just luck. We'll just say it's luck. Yeah, it's cool. It's awesome. Like it's literally just luck.
Okay.
what was that song? You didn't give me a chance to Spotify.
That ick thing, like just like you said, you never had that ick thing. It's nonsense. Because when you like someone, you like someone. It don't matter if they have whatever in there.
Yeah, that's it. Like, and if you don't like them enough for that ick thing not to exist, then they're not
then
the person
you don't
anyway.
Like them anyway.
There's going to be even more icky things later on.
Yeah. So,
and if you're instantly like, ooh, then that's not the one. Yep. Like you might hang around because something else is fun, but that's not the one that you're going to, you know, keep going with because that thing bothers you. And you're like, ooh.
Well, these days, KB, they just give themselves a few options.
They?
People.
People on the couch.
No. People, isn't that right, young boys? You just keep a few options. Do they do that? Oh no, do people do that? Oh, okay.
Nice. You're pretending like you're not people.
Yeah, he's pretending.
I'm just a journalist.
Is that what happens, David?
I'm just a journalist, Gabe. I'm just a journalist, you know.
I'm just an investigative reporter. I'm just trying to get to the bottom
of it. Well, women in general, how many guys do you keep in rotation if you were?
No, but like regardless of that, like that's the point, right? So you never get to know. Like it, whether that ick is too much, because you can, if you don't like something, you can go to something else, and then you go to something else. And if you're really desperate, you can just keep scrolling and find, oh, that's nice, that's nice, that's nice. Oh, I don't need this, that's nice. So you never actually have to get over anything, because you can always move on to something more fun and immediately gratifying.
Right.
So you never have to get to know yourself and know whether or not you could deal with whatever that thing is, and if you want to. And there's obviously things that you don't at all, but you never spend time going, am I just being superficial? You know, that little bit of spit inside of your mouth, maybe it's not the biggest thing. Or maybe I talk to them. Oh, you got earwax? Oh, like, you know, what's that Eddie?
Yeah, and that.
What was that Eddie Murphy movie, Coming to America? I don't know. You guys aren't old enough. You know Eddie Murphy?
Coming to America.
Yeah. Eddie Murphy? Yeah.
Just checking. And he's... No, and the girl had like wrong toenails.
Yeah.
And like she was perfect. She had wrong toenails.
Guy from Madagascar?
Like, Eddie Murphy's comedian. You should catch up. Anyway. But that's the thing, like you can always find something. You can always find something that doesn't work. And the question is whether or not that thing is too great an obstacle to get over. But if you never identify those things, then you never actually get to know yourself.
Well, I've heard people say, you know, through the grapevine that
through the grapevine. Some of our viewers.
They just make
the six viewers.
They just make the perfect one. Like a puzzle. So there's, you know, the guy for the act, the guy for the money.
Oh, they have a whole bunch of options, so that's the perfect
not bunch. Right? Let's not say bunch. You just have the things you like in a few people. Is this prevalent in any of your friends or anything?
Everyone has a type, is that what you're going on?
No.
You have
three different types to make the perfect type.
Different people fulfill different things.
Never done that. No one's ever done that before. No friends have ever done this.
No,
I got nothing. That'd be terrible.
But speaking from obvious experience,
yeah.
No, this
can
is.
You, can you just elaborate?
Because this through the grapevine.
I'm interested. I'm interested in what you're saying. Explain how that works.
Play the music.
So what I heard.
Wait, what? yes, this is through the grapevine.
I guess in relationships you could do that, but I think in friendship groups maybe. You know what I mean? You got that person that you go clubbing with, you got that person you play basketball with, you got that person that you're at university with. But I've never heard it. Like, and again, this is
So I'm the only one who's
it's called what?
I'm the only person who's ever heard this. I'm gonna be the only honest person here today.
Polyamorous? Are you polyamorous?
No.
Is that what you're talking about?
Let's not do this.
So
let's
basically, this. Culturally, that's fine.
Let's not do this.
It's good to be you.
No.
Where's a 10 for 10 when you need him?
No. I mean, I'm going to be the only person honest here today. Are we really going to do this?
Yes, I'm interested.
It's not poly. It's they don't know of each other.
Oh, so it's not like everyone knows of everyone. Everyone thinks they're the one.
No, you're not in a relationship with anyone.
No, you just have options.
That's what I'm saying.
What you're saying.
That's what I'm saying.
And everyone's
and
happy to be.
Different people fulfill different things in your life.
Rosters.
Yes. I get what you're saying.
Rotations, yes. Rosters.
Yes.
So what you're saying is that you never actually have to commit to anything because you can always sub somebody out and get somebody else in if you're unhappy with that roster.
Absolutely. It sounds crazy, KB.
This that sounds
is,
great.
This is the world
like,
we live
that's
in.
That's awesome. Let's
this
make
is,
that.
This is the world we
live in. But it's only possible because you have social media.
Helps,
I don't know.
I think I
don't know. What it just helps.
Yeah, because it'd be hard to organize. Because also, like in,
you have to create an actual roster.
Yeah, you have a roster, but also like you literally the people that you're with or dating all live in the same area because they're the ones you're in contact with because you don't have social media to get anyone outside the area. Yeah. So to have a roster back in the day, you'd have to, you know, you'd have to be Michael Jordan and go different cities. You know?
Yeah.
You have someone in a different city rather than in the same city and have a whole roster. Yeah. So I think social media helps that. Hmm. What's that like?
What is that like?
Yeah.
I can only understand this because I used to live this way.
You say you used to live this way?
I used to live that way.
What's it like?
It's
is it busy? Stressful?
Very stressful.
Is it fulfilling?
No,
do you feel loved?
You think you're fulfilling something.
Because you're always distracted?
Because you're always distracted. And you think you get that little dopamine.
Hit all the time.
Constantly.
And you'd always be wanted. Because no matter who didn't like you for that day,
exactly.
I got this.
Exactly.
Oh, you said something mean to me. Oh, hey, what's up?
You're exactly.
Like, hey, what's up?
And I don't think at the time you realize, but you don't feel fulfilled. So you're distracting yourself with the weekend. With during the week, whoever you're trying to attract, and you're constantly looking for it if you're in that mindset.
For another roster spot, right? Like you'd constantly be trying to find
an
upgrade.
You're constantly doing that because you're not fulfilled. Or you're just.
But you're also not, again, like you're not looking at yourself and trying to.
Yeah, you're not looking at yourself.
You're just, everything's external. Yeah. And it's always like, that's a thrill, that's a thrill, that's a thrill.
And everything is, what can I show? To make that the perfect situation. That's what social media is. What can I show? I'm showing I'm at a workout.
Is that why you have two phones?
I'm showing. No, this is for work, man.
I'm just checking.
But I can only, that's why I say I'm not going to be the only one. Honestly, I can only speak from that perspective because I've lived that way before.
Yeah, yeah.
And when I tell David this all the time, I don't want to go out. I couldn't care less. I'll wear low socks. I don't care.
I don't care if you don't like my hair.
I don't give a shit about what anyone thinks. And I don't care how good you look. I don't care how.
Yeah. How many followers you got?
Whatever.
How many followers? So one second, how many followers do you guys have? We have a bare minimum on this show. 15,000.
Yeah, 15,000 or less. Yeah, come on. Nah,
all together? Do you guys have 15,000?
Not 15.
That's close. We'll go with three. No. Just checking.
Yeah. But that's the thing. You guys dealt with people during those stages?
No, but just on that, right? So you're at a point now where you actually, if an opportunity came up with a meaningful relationship with someone who you vibe with, then there's still no desperation in it. You're just like, oh, okay, that's cool. Let's just see what happens.
Right.
See where that grows. That's a totally different focus and perspective.
Yep.
Then distracting yourself all the time.
Exactly.
So if it came along, you would be ready for the opportunity, possibly or possibly not,
right,
to pursue that in a certain way, rather than say previous times where you're like, you're out, you're in, and it's a dopamine hit. So I think what we're saying before is, and that's what I'm saying about intention, like what are you bringing to the world when you walk out into it, so that when you meet people, you see them in a certain way as well. Because if you see somebody and you're like, oh, that's an easy target. Or you're like, oh, you're cool. What's up with you? I want to know more about you. So you have intention about who you meet. And it could be the same people you already know, perhaps. Mm. But you've never seen them in that way because you were in a different place. And then when you change your perspective, you see them differently and you're like, okay, I actually value what you're doing now, whereas before I didn't. So I think once you change, it becomes the world is the same, but you've changed, so you see the world differently. I think that's the biggest thing. Like, and I think in the world that is there now, you're told all the time to externalize everything and to get quick hits, and everything's disposable, from, appliances at home, cars, partners, everything. You can change that over, instantly. So you're actually geared towards not being happy or satisfied with like consistency. And it's only through consistency that you'd be able to look at yourself. Right, because if you don't have consistency, like it's boring, you never actually get to look at yourself because you're always entertained. And we're told to entertain ourselves, externalize. So I think once you change that and you start looking at yourself, the whole world changes, and then you're like, I'm happy just doing me. And then if someone comes into that world, you're like, okay, maybe, maybe not, I don't know. I think it's a different world.
But you don't get there unless you start there without going through that.
Yeah, but also a bunch of pain and
so when I ask those seemingly crazy or dumb questions, no, there's a phase there, and you guys know people have been in that phase before,
Yeah, it makes sense. The phase makes sense.
There's phases. Yeah. There's phases.
I don't know that.
I don't think there's anything wrong with any phase, So enjoy yourself. If you're in uni.
If you're 18.
If you're
a producer. You're on David Jones' roster. You do whatever you need to do.
Do whatever you like.
I don't know what you're talking about. No, you do not.
Yeah.
That's interesting.
Good talk, guys. What else is on you guys' spirit? What else is in your spirit?
I want to hear about the Caps. I want to hear about the winners.
The Caps.
What's that doing? You guys are killing it.
Go ahead, miss 34 points.
34 points. Tell us about that. The last game I saw you win was that steal you got. I just walked up the stairs because we had the game after. I can't remember who it was against.
Southwest. Oh, the Pirates, yeah.
You got it. And I was like, damn, they're going to lose. You got the steal. Came down full court, made a lap. I was like, damn, who's that? That was a game. That was the last time I saw you win a game.
Yeah, that was a big sigh of relief after that bucket went in. I think, like, obviously that NBL1 North's a good league. But where we were on the ladder compared to where Pirates were, I think we had the mindset going in there, like, not it's going to be an easy game, but we should get this, so it should be.
I think they had won a game.
Yeah, well, Pirates hadn't won a game at that stage, and we're sitting top five, so we're like, yeah,
should be, if we play good, it should be fine. This should be easy done, and went into overtime. So that was a massive sigh of relief.
And you've just carried that on this season. You guys have carried the vibe on.
Yeah. I think adding some different pieces has like altered, not altered it in a bad way, but we've had to make changes to include people into that chemistry. But I honestly think that's the reason why we're so good. The way we just click together. The way, we just get along so well.
Yeah. And no, you guys weren't here. The viewers weren't here before, but the vibe was really cool before the camera came on. You guys really, obviously, really genuinely like each other. It was light and it was funny, and I think that makes a huge difference when you've got that under pressure, because you know who you are under pressure, and you know what's going to happen, and win or lose, it doesn't matter. You know you've got each other's back, so I think that's a huge thing. So,
how long did that take? You just came to Brisbane. This is your second season.
It's my second season here. I don't know. It was crazy. Whoa. It was almost like
it was after the road trip last year on the road.
Yes.
Like I think being with people day in, day out for like, you know, it was only a 3-day road trip, but like it makes a difference because you're with them all the time. So you get to see people's little habits. You get to form these relationships that, yeah, no, icks, but like, you know, you love. We can overlook icks. We can overlook icks. Like, you know, training, we spend, you know, an hour and a half, 2 hours together, you know, on a Monday, on a Thursday, and then we play a game. But like on a road trip, you're stuck together 3 days. So you get to know people, and like, it's just, I know, I think that definitely helped us last year.
Yeah, getting to know people, Kieran.
It was pretty instant.
Yeah.
Like, we didn't take time, didn't take like, no matter if we're winning or losing, like we went through a bit of adversity with like coaches and stuff, but we stuck together, and I think that was like
the adversity. Main thing of it all. Wow. Hmm.
Did you find that the
what would you mean by adversity? Like what does that mean? I've never really, I don't really understand that.
Go into this.
I don't really understand that. You know? What is adversity?
When you hit a hiccup and you have to come overcome it.
But like with that adversity you're talking about, like I guess you had two choices. You could have either fragmented or you could have come closer together. And you girls chose to come closer together, and therefore, you know, you're able, like again, like through anything difficult, you have choices. And if you choose, you know, to overcome it and work together, then you're closer than ever, right? Like rather than, you know, anything could break up a team. If people choose to, you know, focus on those negatives. But I think that was cool watching that last year, is that, you girls actually came together closer than you were before, and used that to, you know, propel yourselves forward. And it's really interesting that it's carried on regardless of, you know, as you said, personnel changes and a few little changes here and there. It's pretty, again, it's a choice. I think it's a choice. I don't think it's accidental. I think that you actually, okay, that's happening, and we could just focus on that negativity, or we could focus on getting it done and including people into our group and making it work. Again, I think it's choice, so I think that's cool.
What do you do when you don't like a teammate? Like, how does that work?
Steph abuses them and they quit.
No.
Really? Is that how it works? What happens?
I mean, with this group, we haven't had that issue. Like, okay, good.
What do you do, Tam?
If I don't like a teammate,
yeah.
I have no authority. I do nothing. I just keep playing basketball and focus on the positives.
Yeah, I guess you're all trying to achieve the same thing. So I think you have to keep that in mind, right? Like you're all playing to win.
Yeah, it's nice to say that, but we know that doesn't happen.
Yeah.
I think it depends if you care on winning more.
You need a microphone.
It depends on if you care about winning more than like how much you hate the teammate. Like if you care about winning a lot more than how much you hate your teammate, then you're going to do what's best for the team. But if you really don't like that teammate, then you won't care if you win or lose. You just won't like the teammate.
Like it doesn't matter how you feel about someone if you have a greater goal than your own personal feelings.
Yeah, I think that's probably what made us a great team, is all we cared about was winning. So we did everything we had to win.
Yeah, cool.
Do you like let them sit at their own table at dinner or anything?
Well, we haven't had that issue.
Yeah, I think we've been pretty lucky, but I don't think we would do that.
No, we'd still.
No, you guys seem too nice for that.
We would do our best to include.
Do we let people sit at the table by themselves?
Besides, we don't talk. You don't talk to anyone.
I sit by myself. I sit down. No one talks to me. I'm like,
people try to talk to Kieran. People try to talk to Kieran. This is what he does. Yep. Yep. So what?
I sit down. I'm having dinner and like. I'm looking at you and you're like, nah, you can sub me in, I'm out. You're such a zook. Bro, we know each other outside basketball. Nah.
Me and Kieran don't fuck with each other in basketball. we don't like each other.
Nah, it's true, but it's funny though that like people don't even pretend. People are just like, I'm mad at you. I'm going to go sit down. I'm like, fuck, you guys are bitching.
Yeah, that does happen.
No, but seriously, like it's basketball. The game's over.
Yeah, absolutely.
Like, how are you going to respond after? Like, I think that how you respond to your emotions are everything, especially and even during a game, because people get emotional. You know what I mean? Like, you get emotional, you miss shots. Someone took a shot, and I should have had that shot. And but those all three go through.
But hold on, KB. You were once a player. Let's not do this. This is not the theoretical lovey-dovey.
Oh, you don't have control over your emotions?
I'm asking. Was there never a point in your playing career,
no. So
where you would have that hiccup or have that moment of...
No,
of
because if I have that hiccup, that's weakness. So I'm going to be weak and then blame somebody else and give somebody else control over my life. Like, I'm not going to do that. I'm like, okay, you don't pass me the ball, I'm going to go rebound.
That's supernatural, KB.
It's not, but if you do it, then you can be any level you want. And I think that's where people get stuck.
That doesn't happen 100% of the time. You can do it. It's possible. You can do it.
You have to be able to bring yourself back. It depends on how much control you have over your own mind.
The greatest player in the world has that. LeBron James, the greatest player to ever touch a basketball, has those moments.
Who is that, sorry?
Sorry?
Did he say LeBron James?
You know, 2-3. Let's not do this, KB. Yeah. KB, let's not do this. 2-3. What's his new number? I forgot. No, you know, Bron. You know, yeah, the king.
Who's the king?
The king.
Greatest player of all time.
The person who scored the most points ever in the NBA.
Okay, yeah, okay. NBA. Who's that?
The greatest male basketball player of all time.
What about him?
He has those moments.
When what?
Of going at his teammate.
Maybe that's why he's not the greatest. Maybe that's not why he's not the greatest.
So who's the greatest who's never had one of those moments?
Who would be the greatest people who don't do that? I'd say Russell.
Russell who? Who's that?
Like old school guys.
Who's it? Russell who? Who's that? You got to say the last name. You know, like certain people you can just say one name. LeBron. Some other people you got to clarify. I'm just saying.
Bill Russell. You ever?
Okay. Okay.
Bill Russell, 13 championships.
Okay.
13 championships.
Is that when people were having two different, three jobs and stuff?
Jumped over a guy from the free throw line.
A carpenter.
You never seen that video?
He was a carpenter.
He jumped over a guy from the free
throw line.
Just
played on the weekend.
So this is a guy without training, came down on a fast break, jumped from the free throw line, and split his legs, went over someone and laid it up because you weren't allowed to dunk.
So athleticism says you're the greatest?
No, he also won 13 championships.
That's cool.
It was pretty cool.
That's cool.
But I'm saying like the guys like that.
He's had a moment.
The old school guys like that, they talk about like just being completely locked in on what they're doing. They don't find excuses. They find answers. So you can say this all you want. I get where you're coming from and you know, that speaks for itself. But my point is that if you just continually are able to concentrate on what your job is at hand and what you're meant to do and what you're in control of, then you continually move forward on your journey and task and you actually achieve how good you could possibly be. Mm. You're the best you could be, whatever level that is. Now, when you say, haven't you done that? I used to, and I sucked at basketball. I was not good at anything because it's everyone else's fault. The coach didn't like me. They're not getting me in enough. You know, they don't pass me the ball. This person doesn't like me. You know, they're rough. They're fouling me. Where's the refs? Yeah, I used to be like that. And then I realized, what am I doing? Mm. Like they don't care about me. I need to take care of myself. And I started down that pathway. And once I started that pathway, it didn't matter if I was good or bad. It was all in my own control. And so I was always happier because I'd come away from a game knowing exactly what I needed to work on. And then I worked on that. And I think that mentality, you know, allowed me to, you know, achieve an average level of basketball. But then, luckily enough, being able to help people with that mentality and help them achieve higher levels than what they possibly thought they were capable of or other people thought they were capable of, but they had dreams of. And it was, like, literally just the mentality. So if you can just focus on what you can achieve in every single game, regardless of any distraction, then you can be the best you can be. And what else can you be but that? Now,
and so that's what I mean. They need that reassurance more often.
No, it's a challenge. It's a challenge. It's like, what are you worried about?
No, not reassurance. That they need that reminder because, like you said, there was a point where you end up deciding that. Whereas not everyone
it becomes habitual. It becomes a habit.
Yeah. Well, yeah. Not everyone is that supernatural or that aware.
Yeah, you're right. So no one like wakes up like that. That's what I mean. But you make a choice. You got to make that choice, and that becomes the habit.
Yeah. Like, I remember when we were training with you in high school it took weeks of you saying, training, there's no swearing. Yo, we don't complain about fouls. But that took some time to get used to finally be like, oh, okay, I'm going to make that a part of me.
Yeah.
Some people decided to say, you know, oh shit, okay, I'm going to make that a part of me. I don't complain about foul. I don't complain about such and such. Or I don't worry about the outside.
The crowd, whatever, or the opposition, or the hype, or whatever it is.
Weeks and months.
It took years. But the years, point is, it's training. Like, I guess that's my point, is that it's training. And as soon as you go down a different pathway, like, and as I was saying with the girls, they chose to stick together and focus on winning or coming together rather than the adversity.
Right.
Whereas if they make a choice to focus on the adversity, then they fragment and their season's lost anyway, and it was everyone else's fault but theirs. And what I was saying that I really respect what they're doing is they chose to acknowledge the adversity and then stick together. And I think that anyone, any team, focuses to acknowledge adversity, but really focus on what we're meant to do and make themselves better and don't blame anyone at any point, they have an opportunity to be as good as they can be. But if you're going to distract yourself with negativity or adversity or blaming or whatever, then you never have a chance to be the best you can be. Because you're just not focusing all your energy into being the best that you can be. You're actually fragmented. And if you're fragmented, you can't make it.
Abby, what do you prefer, NBL, WNBL, or NBL1?
I think
what's more
very
fun?
Different. I love the level of WNBL. I think and the life of being a professional athlete is really cool. Yeah. NBL1, I feel like I have more fun. Yeah. I think, and fun in terms of outside of basketball. I really enjoy during NBL1 that my life doesn't have to revolve around basketball. My workouts are flexible. We can go grab coffee and hang out after workouts. I love doing that stuff. And I honestly think I play better when my life outside of basketball is fun and better. Yeah, absolutely. Mm-hmm. I've also been through seasons where it was basketball. And I don't think I was as happy then as when I'm here in Brisbane playing NBL1, going to eat at new places, going to try new things with new people.
Was your life always basketball? Because you're a legend, from what I've heard. You're one of the very first, very few people to come out of Darwin.
Our Abby Cubillo
is
the first female to come from Darwin and play in the WNBL.
Stop playing. Don't play around, man. Yo, don't play. You're a legend. So,
was it always basketball?
Not necessarily. Growing up, I played heaps of different sports. Huh. In Darwin, I played netball, basketball, touch footy. My mum played softball, so we're always there. We're always out watching AFL footy. So, it's just a sporting family. I played a lot of different sports. I think once I got to about 12, 13, I had a couple coaches say, look, you're actually pretty good if you want to give this a crack. If you want to give it a real crack, you probably need to focus your energy on that.
What made you believe it? What made you believe it? Because usually you have to see someone in close proximity to be like, oh, I can do that. But what made you believe you could?
Territory is small, so what clicked?
I think probably going to national championships, the first time I went to a national championships and I saw that I could compete with the other girls in different states, I was like, oh, wow, I might actually be pretty good at this. And then some doors opened for me. I had a coach when I was quite young in Darwin who actually was from Sydney, and he was like, look, if you want to try out boarding school and play basketball in Sydney, I could help you do that. So that's what I did. And then from there, it was crazy. Snowballed. I got picked up to go to the AIS, and then I was in junior Australian team. So from there, it was just a whirlwind.
So you've been away from home since what age?
I've been away from home since I was 15.
was that like? A lot of people can't do that.
Yeah. I think, like, I'm always super close with my family, so keeping in touch with them was really important. And I think also it was really exciting being that young and living in a boarding house and playing basketball. Like, it was really
only
cool.
Child?
No, I have two sisters. I'm the middle child.
Oh, yeah, you do have a sister. Yes, okay.
So it was exciting. But, like, I also, thinking back now, you miss out on a lot of stuff. Like, you miss out on birthdays. You miss out on, like, all this different stuff at home. But I guess that's a sacrifice you make.
Did your little sister want to play basketball because of you, or was she doing that at the same time as you?
I wanted initially to play basketball because of my older sister, but my little sister's a bit different. Like, she was she was kind of a floater, I reckon, in her life. She would try a couple things, like, just keep to herself, never really super passionate about anything. But I think, like, basketball was always there and she enjoyed that. So, and I think having me and my older sister and, like, my family around basketball a lot, I think that, like, encouraged her over the edge to want to play and stuff. And, I mean, she must be enjoying it if she's still playing now. Otherwise, why would she?
So do you see yourself as a leader now?
Yeah.
With all those accolades?
Yeah, I think so. But I don't necessarily think it's from the accolades. I think it's from the teams I've been involved in and the leaders that I've had around me. Like, I've played with some incredible people, like Kelsey Griffin, Leilani Mitchell, Kelly Wilson. I've played under, like, Shannon Seabom, Paul Gorris. Like, I've had heaps of cool people to be able to play with and play for, and I think that's definitely helped sculpt me into the leader that I am and trying to be.
Do you have any moments where you're like, I don't want to do this?
Yeah, actually, to be honest, before I came to Brisbane, my last season with the Capitals in Canberra, I had been there for probably, I was in Canberra, I think, for like 4 or 5 years.
Okay.
And towards the end of it, this was like when COVID was happening, so it was a shitty time anyways. I was living in this tiny shoebox one beddy apartment that, like, didn't have any windows that opened up for fresh air. Like, it was crazy. And, like,
I heard the water's not the best there too.
In Canberra.
Oh, sorry, Adelaide. I'm thinking of Adelaide.
Oh, no, Adelaide's beautiful.
Okay.
Yeah. But, the water's great in Adelaide. But when I was in Canberra, so that's kind of, and my life, like I said before, was like basketball. And then towards the end of that season, you know, you're not playing a lot. And, like, you're kind of secluded because of COVID. Like, that probably was a point in my life where I was like, do I even want to play? Like, why am I putting all this effort and energy into this to really not really be rewarded at all? So then I made the decision. I was like, look, I hadn't really heard of the Brisbane Caps, honestly, before that. I had a friend who was playing for Logan.
Yeah.
I know.
You heard that?
Sorry.
Yeah. You got to step up your game, Caps. Golly.
My friend was playing for Logan. She's like, look, there's this Brisbane team that don't have a point guard. Like, I'm sure they'd love to have you. To be honest, I don't think the Brisbane Caps knew much about me.
Who's your friend?
Michaela Roof.
All right, Michaela Roof. Thank you.
Yeah. Thanks for shouting out, Caps. Roofy,
appreciate it. Thank you very much.
And I was sort of at, like, this point, like, do I want to play? Like, is it worth me, like, doing all of this to, like, not even really play? Like, putting in all this effort. And then I came to Brisbane, and I think that's when I learned that when my life outside of basketball is good, my basketball is really good. So, coming here was pretty much a blessing.
Thank you, Michaela Roof.
Thank you, Michaela
Roof. Shout out to Michaela Roof. That's awesome. So that revived your love for the game.
Yeah, I think it did, definitely. Now I don't ever see myself just being basketball. I don't think I would ever do that.
It's coffee and basketball.
Coffee and basketball, absolutely. Nice.
And good people.
Where? No, I'm just joking.
On the couch. Shout
on the
out,
couch.
Guys.
Shout out to the people on the couch.
Are the leaders on your team?
Do you have a leadership group? Or
is there a leadership group?
A rough leadership group. I think we
do
all.
You have a captain?
Yeah, Anna. Anna's the captain. Okay. Yeah. She's great. I think, like, the. There is sort of like a leadership group. I think we all respect each other enough to listen to what other people have to say. So when someone's going to say something, it's like, oh, they're obviously saying that for a reason. Like, let's all pay attention to that, whether that's one of the young girls sees something that, like, could help us be better, or whether that's Steph saying, like, guys, pull your head in sort of thing. Ooh. I think
does,
we
does
all...
Does Steph say that? Does Steph step up that. And she yeah. yells at you?
In a nice way, right? Of course.
No, she doesn't yell at anyone. She just, like, keeps us accountable. And I also think that's a big reason why we're successful, because we can do that for each other and not get offended by it.
Is there anyone that, like, keeps the refs accountable too? Or, like, is there anyone who...
Bronte.
Is there anyone in your team that you know, yeah, has conversations with the refs?
I think we all go have a word, right?
Yeah, we all have a word yeah. that we need to.
Mm. Double every now and then.
Anyone, like, start fights and stuff on the team or initiate?
Like,
confrontation, not
between
real
us or with
no,
the
no,
other
with
team?
Other teams, like confrontations with other teams or anything like that.
Nah, I don't think so. I think we're too invested in, like, what we're doing, and I think that's so great. Like, when we do something really good, we're like, yep, let's get around that person. They just made a great shot. That person just made a great pass. Like, let's get around that. I feel like we don't give the time to, like, be affected by that sort of stuff. Yeah. Which I think is a big advantage for us. Yeah,
what did you say, sorry?
I said, like, we'll notice, like, other players on other teams, like, absolutely hating it when we get around each other and stuff, and you can just see it, like...
Yeah, I think it just saps all the energy.
Yeah, yeah. It's great.
Because if you just focus on yourself, the vibe is just with you girls, then no one else, you're untouchable, because you're just, like, absolutely. Doesn't matter what they do, you're like, don't worry about them, let's just focus on us.
Holds hands behind the couch. I think we do a great job of that, though. Like, we don't feed into... any negative energy, and I think there's enough positive energy within the group. If someone is having a shitty game or someone gets caught up with the refs, we're quick to, like, pull them back in and be like, it's just a basketball game, we're fine, like, we'll move on to the next thing, we'll fix it, we'll be better next time.
That's pretty cool.
Yeah. Up the Cavs.
If you had to leave your dog with someone on the team, who would you least leave them with? I'm assuming you all have pets. You all have pets?
I don't have any pets here in Brisbane with me.
Oh, okay.
But I not leave it with?
Yeah, who would you not leave?
Steph, who would you not leave your pet with?
Who would you not leave your pet with on the team?
Nobody. None of
these.
Look
at me trying to create drama. Who are trying to create drama on the team?
And Tim's like, you guys are doing too well. Let's just find something.
Let's bring this down a notch.
You don't have to answer that. I think you guys are on a vibe.
Yeah, remember you have two.
And I think
you
have... Your
plane is going down. You have two skips. At least...
It's definitely Abby flying the plane. Yeah. If it's going down, it's Abby. The rest of us are too loose.
That's funny. Nice. That's perfect.
That's dope. I want to... All my other questions will be trying to bring you guys down a bit more.
Try your best.
No. Let me put the heat somewhere else. Because you guys are, and it's really cool. Annoying sometimes, but really cool. Be on the bench and you just hear these. When we're on the away games, you just hear these references and language.
What do they say?
From us?
I just, you know.
I think we hear the mic over to
hear a bit of yelling and passion. We call it passion. We hear passion. And I remember you guys asking one of the boys, you know, like, are you coming to our game? And they said no or something. Is that annoying with the teams you've played with before? Did this happen in college too, where the men's team don't come support your team the same way you guys support them? Is there any feelings with it?
It definitely happens.
Yeah.
And it is annoying. But again, it's more of, you know, and I think for us, we have more fun celebrating together.
Yeah.
You know, like, we love, unfortunately, you know, watching you guys lose, but, like, we have a lot of fun doing it. Like, it sucks. Like, not gonna lie.
Fortunately. Did she say fortunately?
Look, we have a lot of fun watching you lose. Let's just losing because we are one club, except you guys are letting us down.
Up the cap.
Did she just flip that on you? That was awesome.
She just turned that heat right back.
Yeah. I think the toughest thing is because we're getting ready for a game. You know what I mean? Like I can watch that first hour, but then I've got to start thinking about the game. Whereas you guys are done. You've won the game. You're cheering. You're free to do whatever you want. Like, it's actually hard to, like, well, because I've got to, at some point, you got to think about what you're about to do. Yeah. So I think it's just that, like, I don't know why girls' games always before the boys' games. Like, flip it.
That's the one thing that makes sense. Logistically, it's just difficult. Logistically, it's difficult. You're preparing for...
Yeah,
your game.
Would you come and watch us if we were before you? And at what point would you leave to get ready for your game?
Right.
Yeah, you know that's fair. Like, how many of you guys are coming though from the start of our game to watch? How many of the teams doing that?
Not many.
I saw Donnie last night.
Not you?
I definitely saw Donnie.
Donnie is. There was a time when
I think that's the thing though. Like, we know you've got to prepare. Like, we totally get that. But like.
Where do you want us to sit and what do you want us to say? Because I'm happy to stand behind your bench and heckle you as much as you want.
Yeah, I'll do that.
Right. Yeah, just heckle.
Just go for it.
I need to
yell at anything.
We don't want to ruin your chemistry.
No. Could be. Yeah, we're too busy vibing. We're vibing.
Yeah, we got
to go. Now we got to think about it because I'm not good at hating.
Heckling?
Not good at heckling.
You're great at hating. Your hate is just like.
Low level.
You won't hear it. I'd have to
heckle the coaches. Dean would have to bite back.
There's no coaches you don't like out here.
Heckling. Heckling's like, you know, hating is fun.
What would you say?
I don't know.
Yeah, what's your go-to line, KB?
Go-to line?
Yeah.
I don't know.
If you're heckling someone.
It's relevant and situational. So it'd be like something would happen and you'd have to say it in that moment and you know that's what he's thinking. You just point it out to everybody and it just cuts to the bone and he's like,
you use sarcasm. I don't know if it'll be loud, but yeah, be I don't relevant. Know if you got Kieran's sarcasm.
Relevant and cutting.
It's filthy. Like, nah, I've seen you destroy some careers just with the sarcasm. I've seen you destroy just with the sarcasm. I think it's amazing.
We didn't. I'm nice.
No, we don't.
We don't need to talk about that. I'm just nice and polite and just supportive.
What I think is really dope now, though, is the NBL1 page on Instagram has, like, shot up the viewership for the women's game, and it's shown how much damn near more entertaining it is than the men's. Like, you guys are really talented. And I want to give the NBL1 whole structure their flowers for like showcasing that. They've really been showcasing that. And I think it's dope. And you guys have been on there a couple of times, which is cool. Abby's been on there a couple of times. They've shown you a lot of love.
What were you on there for, Abby?
What was I on there for?
30 points here, six whatever points here, 26 points here, da da da. Damn.
They love you. A really good job. I think like the social media aspect is definitely bringing more people
you're so
to the
media
games.
Polished. I just yeah, that she's was, so right? good. Like, she's like, so really good. Like,
and I like to thank the sponsors.
Really good. Yeah, I like to thank the sponsors. You know, like really good.
I mean, this is genuine.
No, really good at that. That's cool. That's cool.
So who do we go to for some raw, honest opinions? Who gives us that? Unfiltered.
Steph.
Yeah. Steph? Yeah. That's why she says nothing.
Well. Yeah. Yeah. I think Lily will tell y'all what she thinks.
Okay.
Yeah.
Keep that in mind.
Yeah, not many people do that. Yeah. We just don't have any sponsors, so we can say what we want.
Everyone's left the men's program.
Okay, like, so. Yeah, any...
Anything else you guys want to talk about?
Anything else in you guys' heart that you've been searching for, that you've been, anything that's been annoying you in your lives, anything that you're interested in besides basketball, anything in your spirit, anything you found.
Or just basketball.
Anything you would like to let a younger girls know.
That's a good one.
What did you ask?
Younger girls.
Let's go down the line.
What did you say?
Something they would like younger girls to know.
Younger girls.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
I love it. Go down the line. Go, Bronte.
Something that you'd like younger girls to know that you wish you had known when you were.
Yeah.
Can you stop, please?
Go ahead, Abby. You're still a young girl.
No, you go.
Okay.
You're the one trying.
Pretend you're having a conversation with your younger.
I think if I was talking to my younger self, I would say you need to understand that you need to sacrifice a lot if you want to play sport at a high level. But I think you also need to enjoy the whole process. Mm-hmm. I think that's been super important. I definitely haven't done that the whole way so far, like talking about my last little bit in Canberra. But I think once you do enjoy every bit of it, and once you find that balance, it's a lot of fun.
I think it's like you go back to like it is just a game. Mm-hmm. Like it's not that deep. It's just have fun. <It's not. laughs> Just have fun.
Yeah.
I think for me it is just like go for every opportunity that you're given. I think like you can travel the world just playing a sport and be done, you know, like by a certain age and have seen a lot of the world, and you've got to take every opportunity. And if you're not having fun, don't do it. You've got plenty of other opportunities mm-hmm. you can take as well.
Yeah, I think I'd have to piggyback off on that, because like opportunities are everything, and like you don't know what can happen from opportunity. Like you can meet people that will be in your wedding from like 2 years in college, and you may not speak to them every day afterwards, but it's the opportunities that like really matter in the end.
Wait, you were in Hawaii, right?
Yep.
What's that like, real quick? The oceans and all that
cool
stuff? Yeah,
it was great. Like, after going there, I never would have went anywhere else for college just because of the culture. Like, the culture there is absolutely incredible. People there, the place to live. Like, I wouldn't live anywhere else for college. Oh. Like, it was incredible.
That's cool. Kieran almost shipped me off to Hawaii when I was in high school. You remember that? He tried to get me out of here.
I did try. Were you grade 10?
I was like,
that would have been a great opportunity.
It would have been great.
You would have.
So I got stuck with you.
That's it. You would have gone straight into Division One Hawaii.
Hawaii team.
Hawaiian.
Yes.
Pineapple and pizza.
Yeah. Pineapple on pizza.
That's what it is.
Hawaiian pizza.
Pineapple on pizza.
Pineapple.
I used to be a very hard no. Now 1 or 2 or 3. I don't know.
Only three bits.
Nah, you're a psychopath if you like more than 5 pineapples.
Call me crazy, honestly.
Oh, that's ick.
No, that's
it. Full circle. Oh god. No, thank you guys. Thank you guys. Thanks. I hope people appreciate that. Thank you guys for coming here. Thank you guys for us.
Yeah, that was cool. That was Thank you very much.
For sharing. That was really awesome. We'll do a round 2.
When we get our first win.
Yeah. Let's just do
What's
that.
What's their name when Next they get week. The first win?
One.
We'll be back then. One. It's guys. One.
Wait, we might just leave it with one.
Leave us with some Taylor Swift.
Here we go.
What's your favorite Taylor Swift song?
My favorite Taylor Swift song. It was the one that I played, but I have another. I have another favorite. Do you have a favorite a request?
No, I don't.
You guys aren't really Swifties.
Swifties.
Yeah, you're not really Swifties. Yeah, so not everyone could be. Swifty. And everyone could be a Swifty. Not everyone can be a Swifty.
Recording
the whole mic's
up. Yeah. Never pressed record the whole episode.
Oh, that's happened before.
Oh.
It's terrible. No, it didn't happen now. No, we're good now. No, we're good.
No, we're waiting for you to play your song.
Yeah. The Wi-Fi is messing up. But
not the 4G. Not the 4G.
Yeah, it's terrible. It's terrible.
Can someone hotspot attempt real quick?
Jump on the ox.
A little bit of acapella on the couch. I'm all right. Here we go.
You were on.
Next.
Them. We'll get there eventually.
What are you actually doing on it?
Yeah. He's swiping.
Yeah, he's on Tinder.
Yeah, we can sing something. You know, it's really not. It's not letting me. It's not talking to me. It's one of Taylor Swift's first songs. One of her first.
Love story.
Ah, they caught me.
Ah, that's what I was going to put on there.
Love story. Relevant to this topic.
I don't know nothing about this. I don't know nothing about this, man. What you know about this, KB? KB, just...
What's that love story, though?
Think back to when you had long hair back in Townsville.
We were both young when I first saw you. I close my eyes and the flashback starts. I'm standing there.
It just wasn't the 90s.
On a balcony in summer air. See the lights, see the party, the rockets.
Y'all can sing. Don't let me do that.
Say hello.
Taylor's gonna come for us on YouTube. We'll have to cut this for sure. This won't be on the episode. Yo, you know you can sing, right? Come on, Donnie. Come on, Donnie. Pull up, bro. Come grab a mic.